guinea pigging me. That's all right, though. I see how they are. Let's do 5.4 and then we'll do 4.7. Very well, very possible. Baby done got sideways. Amen. It's good to be in God's house this morning. Amen. Praise the Lord. Thankful God's given us another opportunity to be here in a lot of places we could be. Amen. Place I deserve to be, place called hell, but God's let me be in his house this morning, and he's allowed you to be here, and I thank God for that. And we're just excited to see what God has in store for us this morning. And came to worship him. Amen. Lift up his name, glorify and magnify him. And that's why we're here this morning, is to make much of Jesus with the brothers and sisters in Christ. And I'm thankful that we can assemble ourselves together, amen, in this day for such a time as this. And just come together in strength and in unity. And amen, make much of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. If you got a blueback hymn when you're able, you stand to your feet this morning, help us sing this. 524. 524, I'm thankful for Calvary this morning. Amen. Mercy there was great, grace was free. Years I spent in vanity and pride, caring not my Lord was crucified, knowing not it was for me he died. Oh, mercy there was great and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary. By God's word at last my sin I learned. Then I trembled at the law I'd spurned, till my guilty soul imploring turned to Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. Calvary. On the third night. tortured soul can only sing of Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary. Oh, the love that drew salvation's plan. Oh, the grace that brought it down to man. Oh, the mighty gulf that God did span. Amen. If you're able, turn to page 470. Page 470. While you turn, and I love the chorus of that song. Amen. One we sing a lot. And amen. If you've been in church long, you've sung at Calvary. But it says, "Mercy there was great, grace was free. Amen. The pardon was multiplied to me. My burdened soul found liberty at Calvary." Amen. Hey, mercy was great at the foot of the cross. Amen. Grace was sufficient. Amen. He said that His grace would always be sufficient. Mercy there was great. Grace was free. Amen. And He pardoned my life. I wouldn't have to go to hell. The burden, amen, of this life, the burden of hell, the burden of sin. Amen. Even though I live in the flesh, I'm not of the flesh. Amen. And I'm thankful that I'm one of His this morning. And one of these days, amen, all that He's done for me will come to fruition. That inheritance that I have, that I've obtained, amen, will come to fruition. It'll be mine. And there's coming a day, one of these days, when it's all going to be over. Amen. No more sickness, no more darkness, no more, amen, sorrow, no more pain. One of these days, we'll be with Him forevermore. Amen. On the happy golden shore. I come to have church this morning. Amen. You can turn your frown upside down. And amen. Or you can sit around and pout about it. But I've got something to be thankful for this morning. It's the fact that I don't have to go to hell. Amen. I really get to go to heaven. And now that may not do anything for you, but I know me. I know who I was. I know what I'd done. I know what I deserved. And it may not seem like a lot to you, but heaven's still sweet to this old boy, because I know what I deserved. What a day. Glorious day that's going to be. Let's live it up this morning. Amen. Turn it down up here. It's 100. Amen. Sing it out now. There is coming a day when no heartache shall come, no more clouds. And for verse one more time. Stay hanging. Just play, Miss Grace. I want to say this. I'm not trying to preach this morning. Amen. But you think about this verse. Amen. Right here. I know we sang it, but I can't get over it. The fact that there'll be no sorrow, no sickness, no pain, no parting. I'll never have to say goodbye again to anyone, Brother Michael. Amen. I'll get to say hello once again to those loved ones that's went on. Amen. I didn't say goodbye when they left because I knew it wasn't the end. Somebody help me this morning. Amen. I didn't go walk by and say goodbye because I knew it wasn't the last time I'd ever see him, but it's I'll see you over home. And when God makes that happen and that takes place, amen, it won't be, there'll never be another goodbye, no more parting over there, no more pain, no more sickness, amen. The way I seen them when they left, Brother Brad, it's not going to be how I see them when I see them again. Do you hear me this morning? Amen. They won't have all those tubes running to them, amen, and monitors on them, Brother Stan. Amen. When I see them again, amen, they're going to have a new body, amen, a glorified state, amen, and be like unto the Son of Man. Hallelujah to God this morning. Amen. There'll be no more parting. Hey, I'm telling you this morning, that does something on the inside of me. Amen. To know that the pain's gone, the sorrow's gone, the sickness is gone. Amen. The parting will never be ever again. Amen. There won't be the first. Hey, there'll not be casket maker, won't make it in heaven. Amen. He'll be out of business. Hallelujah to God. Amen. Hospitals won't be in heaven. Out of business, thank God. Amen. Funeral homes, out of business. Amen. Thanks be unto God. What a day that's going to be. Amen. Let's sing that second verse. We'll finish with the chorus. Amen. We'll move on in the service. You think about what you're singing about this morning. It'll do you some good on the inside.
There'll be no sorrow there, no more burdens to bear, no more sickness, no pain, no more parting.
Here's the best part.
And forever I will be with the one who died for me. Day that will be.
Sing it with all you got.
What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see, and I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by promised land, what a day, glorious day that will be.
Amen. Glory to God. Amen. Thank you for standing. You may be seated this morning. Amen. And forever I'll be with the one who died for me. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. I get a shot of the cane helpets over what, amen, the sorrow that's going to be gone and all that. Amen. But it starts getting, amen, more than I can handle when it's, I'm going to be with the one who died for me. Amen. Ain't another one like him, Brother Sam. Nobody else would have done what Jesus done for me. Amen. Amen. Greater love hath no man. Amen. Then a man lay down his life for his friend. There's no greater love. Amen, than what the love of Jesus Christ for us as a sinners, and while we were yet sinners. It's one thing to die, amen, for one that is righteous or is good, but amen, and while I was yet a sinner, Christ died for me, and I'm thankful that he loved me anyway, amen. He loved me anyway, and thanks be unto God for that this morning. It's good to be here. Thank God you're here, and amen, just excited about the service this morning. I want to go right into announcements and give you this. Wednesday night service, the Wednesday night prayer meeting service will be moved this week to the Crescent School Building there on West Main Street in order to support the Art Community Revival. There'll be no UFC youth services here at the church either. That being said, for our youth workers, We'll not have youth this Wednesday, and then next Wednesday is the Wednesday before Thanksgiving. So as we, all of you know that we're here last week, I tried to make sure you got that word, and many of you already knew that. But do want to remind you of that. There'll be no UFC this week. There'll be no UFC next week. We will have church the Wednesday before Thanksgiving. There'll be no UFC that Wednesday night, though. So that's finished us out the month of November with the youth, and we'll pick right back up and jump right back into it full swing. Good Lord willing, we're going to, try to get some of our teens this week and get them to the meeting. I think they need to be around the things of God. Do them some good to be around the things of God. One thing I've learned and one thing I do know is this. I've not always done right. But one thing that will stick with you from now through eternity, is moves of God. As a young boy, I was a part, of some things I could go back and remind you and tell you of when God moved in a service or in a situation or in a meeting, and I've never forgot that, That's what, some of our kids need those kinds of memories, Hey, there ain't nothing wrong with remembering, that special birthday or, Dollywood or what, but they need to also be able to remember that God moved in that place and in that meeting, So we're going to try to get some of our young people there at least one night that week if we can. Just beg God to do a work. So if you would you make that a matter of prayer this week, today, this evening, tonight, tomorrow, throughout the day, each and every day, would you make it a point to take time out of your day and pray for that meeting this upcoming week as we just try to mind the Lord and seek God's face for revival in our community, in our churches. And in this nation that we so dearly love. But do want to make you mindful of that. So there'll be no prayer meeting services here next Wednesday, no UFC here next Wednesday. Also, Brian Cannon will be set up downstairs following the morning and night services to take pictures for the new church website and directory. We've got to have your pictures, so please, if you haven't done that yet, please see Brother Brian. Don't take long at all. He can take that picture, and that'll be taken care of. Brian, you're not doing it downstairs anymore. I'm sorry. Amen. It'll be up here, up front, somewhere about this bench. So just see Brother Brian if you haven't got your picture taken yet. Please do that. That'll help us out so much, and it won't take long, I promise you, just to take that picture and be on your way. So please do that if you haven't done it. We've already made mention of it. Just want to, give you specific times and dates. The Ark Ministries will hold a community revival beginning tomorrow night, starting tomorrow night, November the 15th. It'll go through Friday night, the 19th, at Crescent School here in Greenville. If you aren't familiar with where that is, please get with one of us. You can type that in if you're tech savvy. You can type that in on Google or whatnot, and it'll take you right to it. You say, "Well, Josh, that's not me." We can get you to it, especially if you're from around here. Amen. We can use some different landmarks and it's not hard at all to find. So, but there'll be special preaching and singing each night. Service will start at 7 o'clock, 7 o'clock p.m. each night. And then Saturday, November the 20th, the first annual art banquet will be held at 5 o'clock p.m. at the Crescent School venue as well. So we're going to have the revival meeting there in the auditorium. And then Friday night and Saturday, we're going to, turn that from a sanctuary to a banquet-style venue with tables and chairs set up and different things to provide a meal. There'll be a presentation of the ministry, also a silent auction and a fundraising drive to support the art ministries. If you haven't purchased a ticket yet, would like to, I'll say this for it. I know what the food's going to be, and I know who's catering it, and you'll not get it for $10 anywhere else. So if we can't drag you there with the ministry and the silent auction, just come and eat. I know how Baptist folk are. Amen. You dangle some meat and some potatoes and gravy in front of them. Hallelujah to God. Amen. You'll not get that meal for $10 anywhere else. That's a promise. Hallelujah. So buy a ticket and come eat. You say, "But Josh, I really don't care about the." Well, come eat. Amen. Who knows what God might do while you're there. So if you haven't purchased your ticket, see one of us. Me and my wife, Ms. Holly. Somebody. They're also at the Ark Thrift Store. You can purchase those through the week. But if you want to catch one of us after service, out in the parking lot or something like that, say, "But Josh, I'd like to get some tickets." We'd be glad to get those to you, as many as you need. So come out and be a part of that. Please try to make the services this week if you can. Amen. I trust they'll be a blessing to you. And then also the banquet there at 5 o'clock on the 20th, Saturday. So, and don't forget about the Trumpet Series broadcast, the Bible study broadcast that's live streamed daily at 11 a.m. on Pastor Facebook page and also uploaded on YouTube. I know some of y'all are familiar with that and watch that. And amen, it is a blessing. The good thing about it, if you can catch it live, that's, amen, praise the Lord, wonderful. But you can always go back and watch that, and I encourage you to do that. You say, but Josh, I can't watch it at 11 or 12 or 1. Amen, well, go back and, amen, watch that when you can. It's good education on the Word of God and just a Bible study. And, amen, I don't ever want to think, I'll die a student of the Word. I'll never know it all. Amen. Neither will you. Amen. It's inexhaustible. It's God breathed. And if you think you're ever going to obtain, amen. Paul said, I'm not yet apprehended. Yeah. Amen. We ain't ever going to get there. So I can always, amen, use some more study tools and some educational broadcast as such. So I thank God for this. And if you haven't watched it, go back and watch it and get in on that. I trust it'll be a blessing. Also, Recovery Soldiers will be with us next Sunday morning for service next Sunday morning. So that'll be a treat. Don't miss that. Recovery Soldiers will be with us for next Sunday morning service. So we're excited about that. Have I missed any announcements at all? At all? Anything? Yes, sir. That's this Saturday. Thank you, brother. So we'll have the prayer gathering Saturday, November the 20th, 11 o'clock at the courthouse on Main Street. So let's all come out and take part in that prayer gathering there at the courthouse, 11 a.m. Saturday, November the 20th. Anything else? Amen. All right. Just by way of prayer request, I'm going to go through this list, and amen, that way we can make sure that any updates that you may have, please make mention of those. But let's pray for the pastor and his family. Pray for Brother Gary and Miss Francis. Also ask that you pray for Miss Cheryl Davis. Pray for Miss Doris Townsend. It's good to have Miss Sarah with us this morning. Please continue to pray for her. Pray for Harold and Nancy Chapman. Also pray for Howard and May Elliott. Pray for Miss Helen Laster. Pray for Brother LV and Miss Shirley. Let's continue to pray for, amen, Bob and Pat Price. Pray for Anthony Price. Pray for Wanda Norton. Let's pray for the Price family in general. Continue to pray for Case and Bailey. Pray for Miss Winona Fox. Pray for Will Waddell. Let's pray for Mark and Lisa Davis. Pray for Daniel Gray. Also continue to remember Miss Ellen Stafford. Let's pray for Michelle Thompson. Also let's pray for Scott Dunbar's dad and stepmom. Continue to pray for Miss D. Dunbar. Let's pray for the Knott, Brother Anthony and Miss Joanne as they're traveling. Pray for their son as well, Tony and Michael. Pray for Sherry Britton. Pray for Jimmy Sauls. Pray for the Todd Bailey family. Pray for Mike Muncy. Pray for Danielle Blackburn. Pray for Brooklyn and McKinley Knight. Samantha Humphreys. Pray for Shannon Holt. Let's pray for Oscar and Miss Elizabeth Ward. Please pray for them. It's good to have Miss Cheryl Filing. Please continue to pray for her. Pray for Miss Cheryl Griggs. Pray for Jessica Robinette. Let's pray for Jimmy Seaton, Hannah McCoy. Let's pray for Sherry with cancer. Pray for Frankie Smith, Vicki Fleener, Brenda Carter, Jennifer Lewis, Braden Baricki. Let's pray for Wyatt Holt, Logan Daly, Glenn Steele. Please continue to remember him. Pray for Sarah Shelton. Amen. I want to thank you for praying for my mother. Please continue to pray for her as she recovers. Everything went well with that outpatient surgery. We give God the glory for that. And amen. I'll say this, one thing about it. When it's your family, amen, outpatient, inpatient, small, big, it's always a big thing. Amen. And that's something we need to remember. Amen. As we hear these prayer requests, got to go in for this procedure or that procedure, and you think, well, that ain't too bad. Well, amen, if it was you, it'd be bad. Amen, if it was your family, it'd be bad. Hallelujah to God. Amen. So Amen. Let's always look at it from if it was us. And I do. I appreciate the prayers of my church family. And amen. I love my mama. Amen. My wife say amen to that. Praise the Lord. And I do. I appreciate her. And I thank you for praying for her. And amen. I know she's still got a ways to recovery completely. Amen. But I appreciate all the prayers for her. But let's continue to pray for Sherry Calkin. Pray for Fawn Holt's husband. Pray for the Voice of Hope Ministries. Pray for the Art Ministries. Pray for the Trumpet Series broadcast and Bible study. Pray for United for Christ. Pray for our church. Amen. Well, we need to pray for our church. Pray for my wife and I. Amen. The ministry God has us in. Please just continue to pray for us there. We sure do desire your prayers as we just try to mind the Lord. Pray for preachers and pastors as a whole. Amen. Men of God, need the prayers of God's people. No doubt there's targets on the backs of those that's preaching. Amen. Line upon line, precept upon precept, preaching the truth of God's word. There's a target definitely on those backs. And so you need to, let's pray for preachers, pastors. Pray for our country. Pray for the United States of America. Amen. Pray for our military. Amen. Pray for our leadership. Pray for missionaries. Amen. I know I heard on the news recently that they're starting to lift the COVID, you know, the bans for international travel and different things. And amen, know some missionaries myself that's opening the doors for them to get back on the field, amen, or to make it home, vice versa, depending on where they was. So thank God for that, amen, that they're able to get and do what God's called them to do. So let's pray for our missionaries. Pray for young people. Amen. They sure do need our prayers. I'm talking not just teens, but from, amen, the little ones right on up. They need to be bathed in prayer. Let's pray for healthcare workers. Also, let's pray for Miss Joanne's brother, Phil Dunn. I wonder if there's some I might have missed. I'm sure there is. If you would want to make mention of those right now, we'll add that to the list. Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am, Miss Barbie. I'm sorry. Amen. It's good.
And Josh, I know you mentioned the healthcare workers, but as of December the 5th, a lot of them's going to be out of the job because of this COVID mandate. I'm trying to be nice as I can about that, but we're going to lose a lot of our healthcare workers.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Amen. Someone else.
My mom, she's having colon surgery tomorrow morning.
Just remember this. Pray for Brother Brian's mother. She'll be going in for colon surgery in the morning. Someone else. Yes, sir, Brother Bruce. Amen. Let's remember this request. Thank you, brother. Is there another this morning? Amen. Just remember Danielle Blackburn. Thank you for praying for her. Please continue. She's going to have a biopsy done. Please pray for her. Someone else. Anything at all this morning. Amen. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. That's so true. Amen. Tough situation, amen. Family, means of, amen, providing. And have to make a decision like that. So let's pray for them. Amen. God just lead, guide, and direct. And God's able to do more, amen, in 5 seconds than we can do in a lifetime. And if God's people just pray. So let's pray for our health care workers, not just what they're facing on a daily basis as they work, but, amen, what even overshadows that is the fact that they've got this decision that they have to make that's tearing them apart. Amen. So let's please pray for them. Anyone else this morning? Amen. Unspoken request by uplifted hand. Amen. No doubt we all have lost loved ones we'd like church to help us pray for. Let's all that can and will gather this morning around the altar. We'll go to the Lord in prayer. I ask that you pray for your pastor as he breaks the bread of life this morning. Give us what we stand in need of. And as you come, no doubt, may not have been mentioned, but I believe that in every heart on every pew is a need in the house of God this morning. We all have got needs. We are needy people. And I'm thankful there's one answer. There may be 1,000 different needs, but the answer is the same.
Amen.
Amen. That's the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So, amen. I'm going to ask Brother Brad, if you would, to lead us this morning.
Heavenly Father, God, we love you. Lord, we thank you for the opportunity, God, to bow our worthy hand one more time, call upon your name. God, thankful, Lord, that you made a way, God, that we can be back in the house of God this morning, God, gather ourselves with other sisters in Christ, God, to come and assemble ourselves on behalf of who you are, Lord, what you've done, the fact that you saved our soul out of pits of hell. God, God has set us on that solid rock, established our goal, Lord God. Father, I just thank you, Lord, for saving me this morning. Thankful, God, for grace and mercy. God, in the times, Lord, when I failed you, didn't deserve it all. God, you love me anyway. Lord, I thank you for that. Thank you for your forgiveness, God, your mercy and love. Lord, I just ask you this morning, God, would you please, Lord, forgive us where we failed you. God, I never want to come in, Lord, to your presence, God, or into the throne room of grace, God. Lord, a dirty vessel, God. The Bible says we are beneath our heart. Lord, you won't hear us, God. Lord, Father, I beg you this morning, would you please wash us truly? God, please get us from all unrighteousness, God. Lord, you know the desire of my heart. Lord, I want to be pure and holy in the sight of God. Lord, I don't want a speck of dirt, God. Lord, I want you to wash us. God, that we might get what you have for us. God, you can't bless a mess. God, you want to use a dirty vessel. God, you can't fill up a vessel that's already full. So, God, I'm asking you to clean this morning myself. God, fill us with the Holy Ghost. And God, fill this place, Lord. The Holy Ghost of God is my prayer. God, we make the way. The Word of God might have rewards, God. The Word of God might have liberty. Father, then, God, that you break away from them. Word would go forth and accomplish what you have to do this morning. God, I pray, Lord, we see the urgency of the stand, God. Lord, if said many times, but Father, the truth of the matter is, God, we could be gone tomorrow just as well as we're here today. God, we might not meet again on this fashion. Lord, I'd hate to know, Lord, that I missed what you had for me. God, the last time in God's house, God, the whole time I took it for granted, God.
Lord, I
had other things, Father, that was more important that was on my mind. God, I pray, Father, we'd make the most of everyone in God's house. Be sensitive to the Holy Ghost of God. Lord, we try you to have your will and have your way most of all. I pray, God, you'd be magnified above all things. God, you said if you lift up, God, draw all men to you. And I pray, Lord God,
on behalf of our hearts, God, in the wickedness, God, that's crept in, not just in relation to the church, but through the God. Lord, we want to see the Bible, God.
God, those that are recovering, those that are fast asleep, God, this morning. This life is returning to God. Lord, I pray for families, God, this morning. Lord, each and every need. Father, no doubt. God, we can come in, Father. We can put a smile on our face. God, we can dress pants on, God, a collared shirt. God, a dress for the women. God, we can look the part. We can act like everything's all right. God, truthfully, Lord, there's things going on.
God, of each life, each heart, each family. God, our pastor, touch. He breaks the bread of life this morning. God, as he preaches, Father, I pray, God,
bind every demonic force, Father, to touch. God, we're out of place. God, we're not where we need to be.
God, whether it be,
God, our families need you more than we ever have.
Father, Lord, this or that, Father, whatever it may be. God, I pray that you would pop, that you would guide, Lord, and
God,
protect,
to put on and show him,
Father, Lord,
God,
I pray, Father, Facebook Live, God, no doubt, all the people are watching,
God,
Lord,
I
beg you,
we'll have your way,
God,
we'll praise you for what you're doing, Jesus,
God,
name.
Just in this place today, the Lord, by way of Facebook Live, Lord, so many needs, God, I forgot to mention, but Lord, I'm thankful, God, that you know the true desires, Lord, and our needs. Lord, before we can even ask him, Father, Lord, would you do us one thing, God, this morning? Would you show us yourself? God, Lord, would you show us your glory, Father? God, would you hide us, God? Lord, in the cleft of the rock, Father. And Lord, just show us your glory, Father. God, I pray this morning, God, if there be one in this place, Lord, that's lost, God, headed to a devil's hell, God, I pray you convict them. God, you'd open their eyes, Lord, allow them to see, God, they're lost and headed to a devil's hell. Father, I pray this morning, God, for your people and our pastor. Lord, bless our time, God, that we have together. Lord, we'll be careful, God, to say you've done it all in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. This time I'm going to see Brother Sam and Brother Anthony, you come this morning. Amen. Help us take up the our regular Sunday morning offering. If I could get two to come, amen, could I have two young people this morning? Come on, young ladies. Amen. Hey, these young girls will be coming around and taking up our children's mission fund offering. So you give to them, amen, as God laid on your heart. I'm going to ask Brother Anthony if you would to bless the offering, please, brother.
Our Heavenly Father, precious Lord, we thank you, God, once again for another day that you've given us here to be here in your house. We thank you for a beautiful day that you've given us. And God, we just thank you, especially dear Lord, for the sweet spirit that we already feel in your house. And Father, yes. Every song that's been sung, it's been honoring and glorifying to you. And Father, as we impress upon us to move forward in the service, we pray, God, you'll be with our pastor. I pray, God, you'll speak through him, Lord, and you'll open up our hearts and help us to receive what it is exactly you would have us to receive here this morning. If there's one here that's lost, I pray, God, that they will come to the saving faith of Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. Father, we thank you so much for this offering. We pray, God, you'll use it for your honor and your glory. Increase it and multiply it, dear God, and use it how you see fit. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. wife, if she would, make her way this morning. Come on, Miss Ashley. Miss Holly, come as well. Amen. Yes, sir.
Keys.
Help is on.
The Lord. Keep your eyes towards the heaven.
Come on.
Help's coming. Amen.
Come on.
Hallelujah.
Listen.
Look unto the hills from which cometh our help. Our help comes from the Lord. Amen. Praise be unto God. A lot of times, friends, we get horizontal focus instead of vertical focused. Amen.
We
look at the things, what's going on in the life around us, amen, instead of what's coming after. Somebody help me this morning. Amen. We're closer now than when we first believed. Help's coming. What if you give up today? Amen. What if help's coming tomorrow and you quit today? Amen. What if you lay it down today? What if you take the sword and lay it down and say, I can't do it anymore? Amen. The struggle's too hard. The fight's too hard. The burden's too heavy. What if you lay it down today? What if you lay the sword down today? What if you lay your shield down today? What if you lay your helmet off today? What if you lay your armor down today? What if you quit on God today and help comes tomorrow and you give up today? Just hold on. Help's coming. He knows where you're at this morning. He'll not let you fall nor falter. Amen. He will not let you fall flat on your face without picking you back up. Amen. And making sure that you have a way. Just hold on. Help's coming. Amen. Help's coming. He didn't quit on you this morning. How in God's name you gonna quit on him? Thankfully, he didn't quit on me. Amen. He come. Amen. With nobody else. Amen. Would have thought that boy will never do anything for God. He'll never amount to nothing. God said, I believe I'll use that fella right there. Not because of who I am, but because of who he is. Help's coming. Amen. It's on its way. What if you quit today? You might have come in and said, I'm about done with it. Amen. I'm ready just to give up. I'm ready just to quit. The struggle's real. Amen. What if you quit on him today? Amen. And the help you needed shows up tomorrow. Help won't help tomorrow if you give up today. Just hold on, friend. Help's coming, sis, you say. My, my.
Said, Lord, you've seen me, and Lord, you've done me wrong. I've been out here preaching faithfully. Seems you left me all alone. So I said, I'll not speak or mention your name at all. But you
Amen. Praise the Lord.
Amen. I second that emotion. There's times I want to quit.
Yeah, sir. Yeah, amen. Yes, sir.
But thanks to the fire.
Come on.
Burning my soul.
Yeah.
Woo! Three babies.
It's good. Yes, sir.
Bye. Don't lay your sword down.
That's good, brother. Amen. But when I think of what he did on the cross of Calvary, amen, as weak, feeble, amen, we get weak in the fight. Weak, feeble as I am, I just lift up, amen, the old bloodstained banner, and I just march with the redeemed. Hallelujah. Amen. Friend, I don't know what you're going through this morning, but I do know this. Amen. Where are you going to go? Where are you going to go if you quit?
Good job.
Where are you going to go? Yeah. What are you going to turn to if you quit on God? Amen. What's there to turn to? I can't quit this morning because there's nothing to go back to. Amen. There's nothing to quit on. Hey, amen. If I quit, where am I going to go? Hallelujah. But not only that, but I've got a lot to stay in the fight for. I can't quit because there ain't nothing, amen, to go to, but I can't quit because of what's worth fighting for. Amen. And it's been mentioned this morning, families, babies, kids. It could go on and on and on. Lost family. There's too much at stake to quit now. Amen. We've come too far. As the old song says, I've come too far to turn back now. Amen. I do know this. I ain't been in it long, and I ain't the Holy Ghost. I ain't a prophet or son of a prophet. Amen. Check on, amen. We're right where God has us to be this morning. I don't know why. Don't understand. Amen. But I know the Holy Ghost, and amen. That's right on point this morning with where we're at and what we need, I believe, in the house of God. And I'm thankful God knows what we need more than we do. Amen. And I'm going to ask the pastor to come this morning just to mind the Lord. And amen. Be sensitive to the most, amen, most sensitive one in the service this morning. That's the Holy Ghost. And said, Brother Josh, I don't know what you're talking about. Amen. You might need to come get help at an old-fashioned altar this morning. But I'm going to have the pastor come and, amen, just to ask him to mind God, preach what God's laid on his heart. Brother Josh, amen. Go ahead, brother. Girls? Girls?
Yeah. I'm continuing to mind the Lord today, Holly. Dad, can you sing? I need you to. I really need you to. Okay. All right. We're going to preach. It's important that we be sensitive to the Spirit of God today. It's what we're trying to do. Romans chapter number 4 this morning. Romans chapter number 4. Verse number 17, Romans chapter number 4 this morning. Stand, if you would, and reverence the Word of God. I need your prayers this morning, church, greatly. As it is written, I have made thee a father of many nations, before him who believed, even God who quickeneth the dead, and calleth those things which be not as though they were, who against hope believed in hope, that he might become the father of many nations, according to that which was spoken, so shall thy seed be. And being not weak in faith, he considered not his own body now dead, when he was about 100 years old, neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb. He staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strong in faith, giving glory to God, and being fully persuaded. Let me read that again. And being fully persuaded that what he had promised, he was able also to perform. And therefore, it was imputed to him for righteousness. Now it was not written, I want you to underline this phrase, for his sake alone, that it was imputed to him, but for us also, to whom it shall be imputed, if we believe on him that raised up Jesus our Lord from the dead. And can I just say this today? If God really and truly raised up Jesus from the dead, what excuse do we have not to believe God? I want to preach to you today on this thought, the evidence of things not seen. Father, I thank you, God, today for your goodness. Father, I thank you, God, for continuous, ever-present reminder, God, that we are right exactly where we're supposed to be. And Lord, the reason I say we're where we're supposed to be this morning, Father, is because of the intensity, God, not only of your presence, but God, the presence of the enemy, God, on our lives. And God, Lord, I feel, I have felt for days now, God, almost as if it was occurring right in front of my face. God, I have felt, God, a struggle raging, a war going on, Father. And God, Lord, God, it's not a physical war, it's not a tangible war, but it's a spiritual war. We wrestle not with principalities, with powers, with rulers of the darkness of this world, Father. And God, there's a fight going on today, Lord, over my life. There's a fight going on, God, over the future of my family. There's a fight going on over the future of our young people. God, our community, our nation. Father, Lord, and we don't realize, God, I don't realize, Father, the seriousness, God, of the ramifications of this fight. God, my decisions and my choices, every individual choice I make may be the determining factor on what happens to my babies. God, help me to be so ever sensitive, God. God, we're in the middle, I believe, of that Donnybrook moment. God, we're walking a tight line, a tight rope. And Father, it's going to go one way or another. And God, I pray you'd give us the faith. God, yeah, I believe. Would you help my unbelief? Lord, would you increase my faith today? God, help me not to stagger at my circumstances. Help me to stand on the promises. God, help me not to stagger at my circumstances. Help me to stand on the promises. God, I need your grace. I need your strength. I need your mercy. Oh, God, would you please help Father today? Oh, God, would you please help this morning? Oh, God, would you help? Oh, whatever it takes, God, would you please? Oh, God. I love you today. I thank you, Father, for your faithfulness. And God, now I believe you're going to, God, you're going to be faithful. Lord, I believe you're going to be faithful. God, regardless of how heavy the load is and how high the mountain, Father, I don't think there's a person in this room from the pulpit to the pew that could say anything else other than God's been faithful. Lord, you've never failed me. You have never failed me. Oh, I've been through some deep waters, Lord. But there's some here today that's been through so much more than what I have. But God, every one of us can say, God, that you've been faithful. God, if you're faithful to Abraham, you'll be faithful to me. God, if you're faithful to those three boys in that fire, Lord, you'll be faithful to me. If you're faithful to Moses, if you're faithful to Paul and Silas, if you're faithful to John, you'll be faithful to me. God, if you're faithful to Harold Seitler and Percy Ray, Lord, you'll be faithful to me. God, if you're faithful to J. Harold Smith, you'd be faithful to me. And God, I pray that no matter what, though you slay me, God, yet I'll still trust you. Lord, help me not to stagger at my circumstances. Help me to stand on your promises and see it as you see it. Lord, it's as already good as done. God, I'm already seated in heavenly places with you. God, I'm already seated at the King's table this morning. It's as if I'm already home. So God help me, Lord, to allow my faith to be the substance of things hoped for. And Lord, help me to allow my faith to be the evidence of things that I have not seen yet. And we're going to praise you this morning. Thank you for your presence. Thank you, God, for the sweet voice of the Holy Ghost. And Lord, I'm thankful that greater is He that's in me than he that's in the world. I'm thankful that the power of God always has been and always will be greater than Satan. And Lord, I'm just going to wave the victory flag this morning. I'm just going to hold up the trophy. Lord, not because of me, but because I know you already cried out, it's finished. And because of that, I've already won. I praise you to do whatever you're going to do here today. In Jesus' name, amen. You can be seated. In Hebrews 11:1, is everybody minded the Lord today? Hebrews 11:1, the Bible says, now faith is the substance of hope, things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. That's not my text for the message. It is the verse from which I have taken the title for today's sermon. And specifically the statement that is found in the second part of the verse where Paul makes this short but profound statement, the evidence of things not seen. When I think about that statement, it almost seems like a contradictory statement, because the question I can't help but ask in my own mind is, how can there be any evidence in something that has not happened or cannot be seen? Is not the proof of a thing found in the tangible or physical evidence that exists regarding that particular thing? And if I cannot either touch it, feel it, see it, hear it, handle it, or taste it, then how can I know that the particular thing I'm referring to actually exists? But according to the Word of God, faith is the substance of things hoped for. And faith is the evidence of things not seen. So today we're going to do our best to see how that through faith there truly is and that there truly and genuinely can be substance or evidence in things that we cannot see. Do you believe that today? Do you believe that there can be substance of things that you hope for? And do you believe that there can be evidence of things that you cannot see? I believe we find a wonderful example of this in and through the life of Abraham, a man who undoubtedly represents the greatest of all examples of faith in the Word of God. If you want to see or know what faith looks like, just read the life of Abraham. It's one thing for a man to say that I have faith, but according to the Word of God, faith without works is dead. And when it comes to faith, as the old proverb says, the proof is in the pudding. So if a man has true, genuine, and sincere faith, there will be some substance and evidence through the works and obedience of his life to prove that person's faith is real and sincere. There may be reason to question the sincerity of our faith. There may be reason to question the genuineness of your faith. Amen? When our lives are examined, I don't think that anybody could ever question the legitimacy of Abraham's faith. Because from the beginning to the end, there are all kinds of types and forms of substance and evidence to prove that Abraham's faith was genuine and sincere. Let me ask you today, before we go any further, what kind of evidence is there in your life to prove whether or not your faith is real? How's your faith this morning? I'm not asking you how your faith was this time last year or even a week ago, how's your faith right now? And what kind of evidence, if you were to stand before a court, and one day you will stand before the high court of heaven, and it will be determined whether or not your faith was real or whether or not your faith was false. And if your faith is real, there will be some substance. And there will be some evidence to back up the genuineness of it. Nobody had to question whether or not Abraham's faith was real, but let me ask you today, are there questions regarding whether or not our faith is real or whether or not our faith is false? Whether it be leaving his homeland and traveling to a place where he had no idea where he was going or what he would find when he got there. Whether it be the believing of the promise God made to him regarding the giving and receiving of a seed that it would end up blessing the entire world and is still blessing the world today and is still blessing your life and my life this very moment. All because in one moment when he was faced with a choice, Abraham chose to believe God. And the result of that choice is still lasting and having enduring results to this very day. How about the greatest of all episode of faith in Abraham's life when he offered up his only son Isaac on top of Mount Moriah? The life of Abraham is absolutely jam-packed full of one example after another of God proving the genuineness and sincerity of his faith by putting it through the fire and putting it to the test. And may I say to you today that God will put your faith through the fire. And God will put your faith to the test, not to determine anything in His own mind, to expose and reveal to you and to others whether or not your faith is real or whether or not it is false. More times than not, Abraham passed the test. Not always. But most of the time, Abraham passed the test and his faith never wavered. It didn't get weak, but when you study the life of Abraham, you'll find that the overwhelming majority of the times, Abraham passed each faith test God put him through with flying colors. Amen. Two reasons for it again. First of all, to reveal whether or not our faith is real. God knows that, but we don't know that many times. Sometimes I think my faith is strong and God has to show me it's weak. But sometimes, Brother Sam, the devil tries to convince me that my faith is weak and God has to show me that his faith in me is stronger than what the devil wants to tell me that it really is. But the reason God tests your faith, first of all, is to reveal the exact condition of your faith. And when it comes to those times of exposures in your life, you won't be able to hide it. God's just going to lay it out there for yourself and everybody else to see. And you can deny it, you can question it, but it just is what it is. Amen. But the second purpose that God tests our faith is to strengthen it and to grow it. Amen? And to prepare us for greater and stronger tests that He knows will come in the future. Amen. And God knows that where you're at right now, if you stay at that level of faith, all right, if you just kind of stay on a plane and you just are where you are, He knows that 10 years later on down the road, when you come to the Mount Moriah test of your life, unless He puts your faith to the fire now to make it stronger and to grow it to a greater level than what it is today, when Mount Moriah comes, you're going to fail. Aren't you glad God knows what's going to happen in the future? And He knows how to let things happen in your life that are unpleasant, that you don't like, and if you could, you'd go to the other side of the world to avoid those things happening. But God lets them happen to strengthen you, to mature your faith, to prepare you, and to get you ready for another test later on down the road. It's called the faith test. God taking us through the school of faith. How many of you believe today that there is such a thing as the school of faith? Just like when you're growing up, you know, there you have to go to school. And I wish I never had to go to school. But when we go to school and when we're in a particular level of our education, whether it be elementary or middle or high school, we take tests to determine whether or not we're ready to move on to the next level. And if we fail the test, we got to take it again until we pass it so we can move on. But I just want to say to you, when you're in kindergarten, first or second grade, if you were to try to take a test, a high school course, you're going to fail because you ain't ready for it. But what happens is you go from one level and from one stage to another so that teacher and that school can get you ready for what they know lays ahead for you when you take algebra, amen. Or whether you take biology or chemistry, and it's just one test right after another to prepare you and to get you ready for the future. Can I say something to you today? God will never have you take a high school test when He knows you're on elementary education level.
Amen. Yes, sir. That's good.
God will... Do you know the Bible says that? There hath no temptation taken you. And a temptation there is a test. There hath no temptation or test that is taken you, but such as is common to men. Can I stop right there a moment and tell you that the devil wants to convince you in your mind that you're the only one going through whatever it is you are right now? Just like he did Elijah when he felt sorry for himself just before he brought a helper on the scene by the name of Elisha. Amen. He said, I'm the only one left that's not bowed the knee to Baal. And God had to reveal to Elijah that there were some other people who knew what he was going through, who had faced what he faced, who felt the way he felt. He was not alone in the battle. Amen. It's not common to men. And if nobody else understands it, if nobody else knows it, friend, there's a God in heaven. We serve a high priest, one that has been touched by the feelings of our infirmities. He knows how we feel. He's gone through what we've gone through. And I got news for you today. He passed the test for us even when we fail. If you're God's child, you don't have to worry about failing school because Jesus already passed the test for you. Amen. There hath no temptation taken you but such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not tempt you or test you above that you're able. You'll never take a chemistry test in God's school until you're ready for it. You'll never take an Algebra 3 test unless you've already passed Algebra 1. Amen. But will with the temptation also make a way of escape that ye may be able to bear it. You may be hemmed in this morning. You may think there's no way out. You may think that there's no hope for you. But I'm thankful that God, and hallelujah, I'm getting ahead of myself, Brother Josh. But hey, God's able to take nothing and turn it into something. When there's nothing there, God's still able to speak it into existence in your life. What you see today, the worlds that we live in, the heavens, they're the handiwork of His hand. He flung the stars out into the universe from off the tips of His fingers. And if He spoke the worlds into existence, He can take your life of nothing and turn it into something. You may be a nobody here, but He can turn you into somebody. Hallelujah, you help me preach today. Can I just say to you, you're not always going to pass the test. But it's all right, because Jesus already passed it for you. Amen. Aren't you thankful that God has a curve? You know, I'll tell you what, there's times that me failing or passing a certain class when I was in school depended on whether or not there was a grace curve.
Yeah.
Amen? Why? Because I can't always live up to the standard. But I'm thankful that Jesus did.
Yeah.
Amen? And I'm thankful for that curve test, or that curve, that grace curve. Amen? And even when I fail the test, God sees the one who already passed it for me. That ought to make a Baptist shout right there. Amen. All right, let's get into the text today. How does God grow us? And how does God give us the strength to pass these tests in life? Look with me at verse number 17, Romans chapter 4. If you're still with the preacher today, say amen. Now you ought to underline these three phrases. This has got a whole lot to do with whether or not you fail or pass the test of life. As it is written. Did you hear me? Now again, that sucks all the air out of the room because we act like, oh yeah, whatever, preacher, I've heard that before. That is the ultimate factor in whether or not you pass whatever test you're going through right now in life. As it is written. You hear me today? I have made thee a father of many nations. Now this is a quotation that refers back to the original account of Genesis when God first gave Abraham the promise. Did you hear me? God gave Abraham a promise. He said, here's what I'm going to do, Abraham. I'm going to make you a father of many nations. Now there was just a few problems with that. Abraham was almost 100 years old when God gave him that promise. His wife was infertile. She was unable to bear children. So humanly speaking, there was no way for what God said to happen. The promise God gave to Abraham was absolutely and totally impossible from a human point of view. As it is written, I have made thee. Notice he said, I am not going to make you. He said, I've already made you. And again, I'm just all over the place this morning as far as the chronology of when this is supposed to be preached, but I got to give it to you as God gives it to me. There's some things in your life that God's wanting to tell you, and I know y'all going to think I'm a name-it-claim-it preacher this morning, but I'm telling you today, sometimes I'm afraid we allow the charismatic movement and the prosperity gospel to cause us to sell our God short when it comes to what He can do and what He wants to do in our lives. And the truth is, we disguise our unbelief and our lack of faith By thinking ourselves more spiritual, when in reality we just don't believe in a God who can do the supernatural.
Amen.
Amen. I'm telling you, friend, there are some things that God has in store for your life. Now, I mean, this is uncomfortable for me to say, because again, it's just the labels. He's just one of them. Name it, claim it, preachers. But there are some things that God has in store for your life. It's not about what He might do, what He can do, what He wants to do, but what He's already done. If you just believe it. Can I remind you, Canaan land already existed. God had already given it to them. And they could have claimed and inherited it a lot earlier than what they did if they'd only believed God. But they got to the threshold and they looked at the circumstances and they staggered over their circumstances instead of standing on God's promises. They saw the grasshoppers when they should have believed what God said, and they missed out, and an entire generation died and never got to inherit the blessing because they weren't able to reach out and claim what in God's mind was already as good as done. It's not about what God wanted to give Abraham. It's what God had already given to him.
And again, I really don't know where I'm at right now. But if you're saved, you're as good as in heaven. God doesn't see me as being in heaven. God is not bound by time. God does not see things as past, present, and future. It's already done. And I don't understand that even any more than you do. But He said that we are already seated together in heaven. It's as if you're already sitting at the table and having yourself a time at the banquet. It's already done. The question is, do you see it? God sees it. God knows it. The question to you, what do you see this morning? Do you see the giants? Or do you see the blessings that God has already given to you? I know I'm going to get called an aim it, claim it preacher before this is over. But you know what? I don't care. Let them miss out. I want what God has in store for my life. I have made thee a father of many nations. His faith was founded on the promise. Blind faith is not God's faith. God's faith is anchored to a point and a foundation and a source. And it has to do with the Word and the promise of God. That cannot be shaken. Your faith may be shook. God's Word ain't going to be shaken. You may stagger at the promises, but God's Word will never stagger. When God said it, He didn't stutter, bless God. He said what He meant, and He meant what He said, and there ain't nothing the devil, hell, Obama, Biden, or anybody else can do about what God said. Just is. Forever thy word is settled in heaven. That's why you better anchor your life. You better find you a promise in that book, and you better wrap that rope around it. Amen, because when the devil turns up the heat on your life, you're going to need something strong to anchor your ship to and to build your house on. See, what we do is we anchor our faith to the circumstance. That's building your house on the sand rather than on the rock. Anchoring your house, anchoring it to the Word, the promise of God, rather than you. Listen, amen. When you build your house on your circumstance, amen, when the winds and waves blow, your house is going to crumble because your circumstances in your life and in this world, they will change. God's Word will never change. A vision. Verse 17. Before him who he believed. Did you see that? Before, again, as it is written, I have made thee a father of many nations, before him who he believed. Not after, but before. One definition for the word vision means to see the tangible proof, substance, and evidence, reality, and existence of something before it actually exists. Amen? Going back to the definition of faith, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Even though I can't see it, I still see it. Why? Because of what the Bible says. Even though I can't see it by sight, I still see it by faith because God's Word trumps my circumstances. Just because it hasn't happened yet doesn't mean it's not going to happen. Amen? See, that's what a scoffer wants to do. A scoffer wants to take the Word of God and say, well, it has not happened yet, so that means it must not be going to happen. No, it's going to happen. Regardless of whether or not it has happened yet, it's going to happen because of what the Bible says. Amen. It's not a matter of if, but when. Do we see things the Bible speaks about in a future sense? Listen to me this morning, church, both positively and negatively, as if they've already occurred. Do you see the rapture as if it's already happened? Or just because it hadn't happened yet, do you question? Is there a seed of doubt that comes into your mind whether or not the trumpet's going to blow? I'm afraid there's going to be a lot of Christians that are caught off guard and surprised when they hear the trumpet sound. Really? I've about given up on that. Because I waited on it for so long, but just because it hadn't happened yet, I gave up on it ever happening. Just because... Do you see souls burning in hell as if they're already there? Do you have a vision of things you hadn't seen as if they're already... I mean, are y'all with me today? Do you understand what I'm saying? You'll never get a vision until you... Or no, you'll never get a burden until you catch a vision. And what is so hard for us is because we can't see it tangibly. But in order for us to get the burden for our loved ones, we better see them burning in hell as if it's already happening. Because one day, if they don't get saved, it's going to happen. Do you see your loved ones left behind as if they've already been left behind? Crying out to God for mercy? Do you see the wrath of and judgment of God falling on America as if it's already happened? Or do you allow yourself to doubt the reality of it because right now the circumstances would tell us, even though God's given us a neon sign, yeah, but we're still okay. You can't see it because you can't see it. You better see it by faith, even though you can't see it by sight. All right, let's turn to the positive for a minute. Do you see your loved ones as saved, as if they're already saved? Yes, or do you allow the circumstances and the fact, well, I've been praying about it forever and it hadn't happened, so it must, in other words, I'm staggering at the circumstance rather than standing on the promise. Y'all with me? I don't remember, but I've heard the illustration, read so many books, but of the I don't think it was Percy Ray, but the mama whose faith became so strong and sincere that she began going around the community telling people, "Did you hear about my son getting saved?" Although she was still already, or he was still as lost as a ball of high weeds. But she was going around, "Hey, did you hear about my son getting saved?" Right, yeah. And then people started going to him and saying, "Congratulations, I'm so glad to hear." And you know what? God used that to convict him. And then he got saved, and he went and told mom about it, and she just sat there and looked at him. Yeah. And instead of getting excited about it, she said, "Son, I was just waiting on you to find out what God had already told me." That's real faith. Seeing it by faith before it ever takes place. Are you staggering at the circumstance regarding potential for revival? Or are you standing on the promise? Amen. Are you staggering by the circumstance regarding the condition of your family and the need for reconciliation? Or are you standing on the promise? Now, I can say that, but it's a whole lot easier for me to say it than it is to actually live it. You know that, and so do you. Boy, we can preach it, and man, when we're in this pulpit, yeah, but the moment we get out, then it's all about the circumstance rather than the promise. Do you have the vision of God meeting your need and doing for you what you desperately need Him to do? As if it's already done, or are you doubting and questioning because you're focusing on the circumstance? Faith means we have a vision in things we have not seen because of what the Bible says. Can I say that again? Faith means that I have a vision of what I cannot see because of what the Bible says. One reason why people are perishing is because we have no faith The reason we have no faith is because somewhere along the line, the church lost its vision. And because we have no vision, not only do we have no faith, we don't have a burden either. Where there is no vision, the people perish. Abraham believed the promise because he saw it before it ever actually existed or occurred. And you can see that over and over again in his life. Hebrews 11, God said, go. He said, where am I going? I ain't telling you. He went anyway. He went not knowing where he was going. But he went. He offered up Isaac on the altar. And he saw him as being raised up off the altar, even if God had to raise him from the dead. He saw the vision of it. And the vision of the promise was greater than the reality of the circumstance. I've lost some of you. Resurrection, verse 17. Even God who quickeneth the dead. Abraham's faith was grounded in the fact that there was nothing God could not do. Do you believe that? Or do you have weak faith because you're obsessed with what you can see? All things are possible. Is anything too hard? Isn't that what... Sarah's faith got weak, and Abraham asked her, is there anything too hard for the Lord? Now again, that relates to everybody here differently. How that applies to me is different than how it applies to Brad. Amen? Because our circumstances are different, but the promise is the same. If God could do it for Abraham, then God can do it for me. Amen? Do you have a vision of the magnitude of God's power? Do you see the needs of your life and the circumstances that you face within the realm of the fullness and the magnitude of God's ability to meet your need? No, what we do is we allow the tangibleness of our circumstance to overwhelm and to cause us to lose sight of the magnitude of God's ability to work in and through our circumstance. Amen? God's saying, what can I not do for you? Yeah, but God, look at where we're at. Do you recognize the fact that if God can raise Jesus up from the dead, there ain't nothing He cannot do in your life? Is your faith anchored, built, and grounded on a God of the impossible, a God of the supernatural, and a God who can still perform miracles? And this goes back to the Baptist, the non-charismatic aspect. We should emphasize the message over the miracle. But that don't mean that God's not a God of miracles. Do you believe God can still perform miracles? I would go so far as to say that we're in a room full of people that at one point in your life, you have experienced something in your life that is beyond man's ability to explain. I believe that God can still heal. But you start talking about healing and all of a sudden you're charismatic. Call me what you want to call me. We are guilty of shortchanging God. We're guilty of living so far less than what God... Now again, that's not a promise that God's going to heal you if you're sick. It's got to be according to His will. But you must live within the realm of God's ability to do anything. And here's another thing. If you make Him the delight of your life, He will give you the desires of your heart. As long as your desires... match up with His delight. That don't mean, well, if I make God the delight of my life and then I ask Him for a new Porsche or Lamborghini. or a 500,000 square foot house that it's going to be there. No, that's the name and claim it message. It just means that if your desires are anchored and are according to His delight, the delight of your life, then you ask Him for it, He'll give it to you.
So good. Amen. Yes, sir.
What spiritual needs exist in your life that you have not because you ask not? Lord, I just... I don't like you. I mean, we just need, let's do it. Can you do a joint message? I mean, because you ask amiss. He helped me out on that one last week too. But we live so far below. There are some things that it's not about that He can do or He wants to. He's already done it. He's just waiting for our desires to line up with His desires for us. And then He's just like a daddy that just... His heart just beats out of his chest to hear his babies come and say, Daddy, I need this. And because what you want is according to what He knows you need, then He just gives it to you. What is it that you need? See, the devil wants to convince you to feel guilty for asking God to meet your need. Have you ever been like that growing up? Or even today as an adult? See, I think my mom and dad would agree that you never get your babies raised, praise God. Every parent in this room feel that way? Amen. See, just because I'm an adult doesn't mean that I still don't occasionally go to mom and dad and say, I need this. But there are times that I go to them and I ask them for something and I feel guilty. Why? Because I don't fully understand the role of a father and a son. Even though my dad is almost, well, I'm not going to talk about age here, but he's older, and I'm older, doesn't mean that he's not still my dad. And if there's something that I need that he can do for me, it's not as if it's some inconvenience for me to go ask him for it. He's just waiting on it. And that's how the Lord is with us. He's just waiting on us. Don't ever feel guilty about asking God for something that you need Him to do for you. Because the fact is, He's just sitting on the edge of His seat waiting for you to ask Him for it. What is it that you need God to do in your life? Don't let the devil rob you of a blessing because you feel guilty to ask Him for it. Some of you are already messed up. You're worried, oh God, it's... I'm minding the Lord today, church. The stakes are higher than the time on the clock. Creation, and calleth those things which be not as though they were. The emphasis upon the power of His Word. God spoke it and it came to pass. He spoke the worlds into existence. He took nothing and turned it into something. We humans have to have something to create something. You're going to build a house, you've got to have some lumber. You've got to have some nails. If you're going to build, you've got to have some resources. We human beings have to have something in order to create something. God had nothing, but He still made something out of it. And if He did that in creation, He can do that in your life. You say, I don't have anything. Trust God and watch Him take something or nothing and turn it into something. Preacher, I'm a nobody. Trust God. Give your life to Him. Watch Him take a nobody and turn you into somebody. An evaluation. And calleth those things which be not as though they were. The reason God can call things into existence that does not exist is because He sees them as though they do exist and have already taken place. We talked about God not being bound by time. To Him, it's as if we're already there. Amen. In God's eyes, it's as if it's already as good as done. But the question is, how about us? Do we see those things which are not as if they've already happened? An evaluation. Verse 18. Who against hope believed in hope. Even though physically and tangibly speaking there was no hope, yet for Abraham he still had hope. Is that not so relevant to where we're at today? Is anybody going through something this morning that from a physical and a tangible point of view in your mind, there's no hope? Don't y'all act all super spiritual on me today. There's no hope when you look at things by sight. The question is, do you still have faith because of what the Bible says? Do you know, not having hope is an evidence that you don't have faith. Faith and hope are interchangeable. Amen? Faith is the substance of things hoped for. If the devil can get you to lose your hope, he's got you right where he wants you, and the battle's as good as already being over. The reason we're losing the battle is the devil has robbed us of our hope. I could get every person in this room to stand up today, and you can give me the specific need that you have. And many of those would seem as if they're hopeless. There's no way it can be fixed. There's no way it can be remedied. You lose your faith, you lose your hope. You lose your hope, you lose your faith. Do you have hope in God meeting that need? Or have you all but given up? Have you quit? You've put so much effort and time and energy, and your motives are right, and you've done it for the right reason. But yet it hasn't happened yet. In fact, it seems as if it's further away from happening now than it ever has, when in reality, it might be getting ready to happen, and help might be right on the way. But if you lose hope, the battle's over. Imagination. Let me read this verse real quick. Hebrews 11:7, by faith Noah, warned of God of things as not seen as yet, moved with fear, prepared an ark to the saving of his house. I don't have time to preach on that, but I'm just saying a lot of our hope depends on whether we believe it, even though it has not happened yet. Imagination, verse 18, that he might... You underline that word might become the father of many nations according to that which was spoken, so shall thy seed be. The key here is might. See, here we're talking about the difference between the certainty of what God knows and does versus the uncertainty of what we do. In God's mind, it's as if it's already happened, but the question is, will we or won't we believe the word of God? That it might. What might God do? What good could God do? What would God do? What does God want to do? But right now, it's even in His mind, though in His mind it's already done for us. It just depends on how we react. Whether or not we stagger at the circumstances or stand on the promises. Condition, verse 19, and being not weak in faith. Yea, I believe, help thou mine unbelief. Increase my faith. May I remind you, the way that happens is by you keeping your nose in that book that's sitting in your lap and staying on your knees every day. The condition of your faith and your hope depends upon your faithfulness to the Word of God. Faith comes by hearing. And hearing by the Word of God. How many of you need more faith this morning? Amen. Your success in overcoming whatever it is you're trying to overcome in your life right now depends upon the strength or weakness of your faith. Now listen, I'm trying to wrap this up. Please don't let the devil distract you. And that ain't got nothing with that. Amen. I'm used to preaching around crying babies. Hallelujah. Amen. We've got some mountains that they don't just need to be moved. They've got to be removed. See, we say, well, if I've got faith, I can move mountains. That ain't what it says. He says, if you have faith, as of a grain of mustard seed, you can remove. Anybody needs to have some mountains in your life that need to be removed? God says in His mind, it's already as good as done. It's already happened. The question is whether or not it might happen, dependent upon the condition of your hope and your faith. Whether or not you stagger over your circumstances or whether or not you stand on the promises. That's verse 20. That's where we're at. He staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief. How we react and respond to circumstances reveals and exposes the condition of our faith. Do we stagger over circumstances or do we stand on promises? Is our faith easily shaken and easily shattered, or does it remain strong? Paul said, none of these things move me. Neither count my life dear to myself, that we might not be moved by these afflictions because we've been appointed to them. We view it not as an accident or a coincidence, but it's an opportunity for God to test and reveal the level and condition of our faith if we stagger, shake, or allow our faith to become shattered. Our faith is weak. If we stand, withstand, and weather the storm, our faith is strong. Will you pass the test, and do you have strong faith? You know what we need today? We need God's people to quit being spiritual wimps. Giving up the first time the wind starts blowing. We want to quit and give up every time we hear the thunder. We want to throw in the towel every time things don't go the way we want them to go or expect them to go. We stagger at the promise rather than stagger at the circumstance rather than stand on the promise. Our faith is shaken and shattered, and we begin to waver. When in reality, we ought to withstand and continue weathering the storm, trusting God to give us sufficient grace to come out on the winning side. Production. But was strong in faith, giving glory to God. Faith pleases God, and faith gives glory to His name. For you to stagger rather than to stand brings shame and reproach to the name of God. For you to stand instead of stagger means you please God and give glory to His name. How is the condition of your faith? How is God reacting to the condition of your faith? Is your faith putting a big smile on His face? Or is it bringing reproach to His name? Without faith, it's impossible to please Him. Amen? And here's the thing. God's ultimate purpose for your life is to get glory. And God, the best way for God to get glory is for you to stand on the promise instead of stagger at the circumstance. Persuasion and being fully persuaded. Are we fully persuaded on what the Bible says, or will we hesitate because we put more confidence in our circumstances? And that your mind better be made up on that before the storm ever comes. See, that's what's so dangerous about where we're at today, friend, is because the devil is undermining people's confidence in thus saith the Lord. And when the storm comes, they have no anchor, they have no foundation, so they just crumble and are swept away because they're not fully persuaded on God's ability and willingness to make the promise become a reality. A function, verse 21, and being fully persuaded that what He had promised, He was able also to perform. When it comes to God, y'all listen to me this morning? When it comes to God, a promise equals a performance. If God says it, story's over. If God says that He will revive us, no matter what the circumstances look like, if we seek His face diligently, friend, it's not a matter of if, but it's a matter of when. Inclusion, verse 23 and 24, and this is where I finish today. So much more we could have said. Now, it was not written for His sake alone, that it was imputed to Him, but for us also to whom it shall be imputed, if we believe on Him that raised up Jesus our Lord from the dead. Somebody else's future depended upon Abraham's faith. In fact, my future depended upon Abraham's faith. Y'all hearing me today? Thousands of years down the road, the future, eternal destination of people's souls depended upon an individual choice Abraham made, whether or not to believe God or not. Whose future depends on your faith? And I'm closing, but it ain't going to make a difference. I lost some of you 30 minutes ago. All 15 minutes does for us is just how quick we get our belly full. One, this decision, right? Friend, I'm telling you, the decision you make right now. You know why? Because I got a feeling some of you is ready to give up and quit. Can I be honest with you? I am. Y'all know your preacher. He ain't gonna sunshine and roses. He's just gonna tell it like it is. Friend, the devil's been working me over harder than he ever has. We talking about that double portion? You better be careful what you ask for. Because before God can use you, he's got to break you. And you know what happens when God starts breaking you? You start making plans for the future. And I've done that many times. I just hadn't learned yet. God ain't going to let me quit. I can't. Jeremiah tried. Jeremiah was mad at God. Lord, look what I did. Don't you just love the transparency of God's Word? Jeremiah, him and God was having it out. They were not on the same page. He said, I can't. Right, I want to quit. Because I know it's not going to get easier. If you want to listen to these fools on TV that tells you that things are getting better and it's going to get easier, I got some oceanfront property in Arizona I'd love to sell you. You better make up your mind now. But when you make that decision, you're counting the cost, knowing there's going to be some brokenness. There's going to be some times to where God allows your guts to be spilled all over the ground just so He can pick them up and put them back in and make you better than they ever was before. See, here's the thing. There's a lot of times in my life to when I weigh it in the balance, the cause ain't worth the cost. It just ain't. But then, I look, Brother Sam, at whose future depends upon my faith. What's going to happen to my family if I quit? What's going to happen to America? What's going to happen to the young people of Greenville, Tennessee? And it could be, and I believe it with all my heart, and I don't know how and to what degree, but it ain't no coincidence that the devil has turned up the heat to the point of boiling. And it's because of two reasons. It's because he knows the clock's ticking. And the hourglass is getting ready to run out. But secondly, I believe he's shaking in his shoes because he knows help is on the way. I ain't perfect. I'm far from perfect. And neither is that man. Neither is that man. Neither is that man. None of us are. But there's been a whole lot of blood, sweat, and tears. With a genuine heart to see God
It ain't about me getting the glory. I don't care, Josh. I hope you preach Hebrews 11:7 tomorrow night, and I hope that God uses that message to turn America upside. It ain't about the person. I'm just praying and believing that God's going to honor the faithfulness. And if He don't, He's a liar. He's got to. And He's going to. Because I'm not going to stagger at the circumstance. I'm going to stand on the promise. And I'm going to view it, and I'm going to see it, and I'm going to believe it as if it's already happened. And I may walk into that auditorium Monday night, and it may be me and Josh and Dylan. That'd be enough to have revival. And we may go the whole week, and nobody may show up, but I'm going to leave that place Friday night. Even if, in man's eyes, we failed, still believing and still seeing it as if it's already come to pass. It's all stand. Here's the invitation. Matthew 18:18 through 20. Verily I say unto you, whatsoever ye shall bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Did you hear that? Whatsoever we shall bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatsoever we shall loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Again, I say unto you that if two of you shall agree on earth, two, as touching anything that they shall ask, it shall be done for them of my Father which is in heaven. For where two or three are gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst. I want to challenge people this morning. Find you somebody. Maybe it's a husband and wife. Maybe it's a mom and daddy. Maybe it's a family of father, mother, children. Maybe it's an entire family. Maybe it's a fellow church member. Why don't you find somebody and you come to this altar and you grit your teeth and you say, come hell or high water, we're agreeing to stand on the promises rather than stagger at the circumstance. Heavenly Father, I've obeyed You today. Lord, You help me. Lord, surely the presence of the Lord has been in this place. The Word's been preached. The Spirit's moved. The question's up to us. The question is up to us. What will we do? I pray that two or three would gather this morning and become fully persuaded in their minds that what God had promised, He was able also to perform. Father, I just leave the invitation into Your hands, God, to help us to know that we may be right on the verge of having our needs met and our prayers answered. But if that's going to happen, we must be fully persuaded. Almost won't cut it or get the job done. Have Your will in Your way during the invitation. God, help people to be sensitive to the Holy Ghost of God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
You mind the Lord today.
If you've enjoyed being in the house of God today, say amen. 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 Service tonight at 6 o'clock p.m. Be back with us. And I'm just looking forward to seeing God do more tonight than he's done today. Amen. One thing we can say about it, to God be the glory. And can I say this this morning, to God be the glory. Great things. He's going to do, but in reality, it's already as good as done. Amen. Amen. Anthony Moorlock, lead us in prayer this morning, brother.